God is so good. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Listen, if you haven't learned how to worship extravagantly, then you need to do that. You know, this is the School of Spirit. Usually I spend a lot of time talking about being sensitive to the Holy Spirit, how to be sensitive to Him, how to cooperate with Him. Tonight I'm going to talk to you about connecting with Him, how to connect with the Holy Ghost. And because there's absolutely nothing more important than you understanding how to connect. I think that, in fact, in some respects, that connecting with the Holy Ghost is more important than being sensitive to Him. And of course, like I said, many of you have heard me speak on being sensitive to the Holy Spirit. We've got, many School of the Spirits up right now. There's more than 30 of them. And so please, listen to them. I got a testimony today of a pastor in another country said that he watches the School of the Spirit and he listens to them, and his whole life has been revolutionized by it, has changed by it, his family's been changed by it, and his church's been changed by it. I know a great woman of God who's been used by the Lord in amazing ways. She's been used by the Lord and really in many ways more than I have. And when you take about total number of nations and total number of people reached and whatnot. And she's actually taken all the Schools of Spirit and transcribed them. She's actually written them out. She has them in manual. And I think that what happens is when you look at people do that, you realize why they do so much. Why they do so much in God. You understand it. They're just as intelligent as anyone else, but they really hold on to the Word of the Lord. And you want to be able to do that. You want to just don't take things for granted. Don't take God for granted. Don't just say, "Well, I heard that before." Because it doesn't matter how many times you've heard it. What matters is, are you doing it? And there's a big disconnect between those two things. People say, "Well, that's familiar to me, or I know that," but you don't know how to do it. You don't know how to utilize that. The information is not something that you've been able to put into practice. So a lot of people have knowledge, but they don't have wisdom. Wisdom and understanding allows you to put knowledge into practice. And so we want to give ourselves to it, because the Lord is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. That's one of the most important things to know about God. He's going to reward you. You're not going to do for something for Father and not get paid for it. I'm telling you right now. He's going to reward you big time. And the payment's far bigger. Most of the time, it's much, much, much bigger than, some financial compensation. That's the least of it all. And the Lord take care of your financial needs, but that's the least of it all. When you hear me talk about sensitivity to the Holy Spirit, you hear me talk about giving yourself over to love and joy and peace and kindness and gentleness and meekness and godliness and not allowing the things that run contrary to God to have place in your life, that really then begins to develop you that much more to being sensitive and not allowing a bunch of garbage and filth. There's so many Christians sit down and they'll listen to a bunch of garbage and filth and call it entertainment. There's no filter on that. You wouldn't stand for somebody doing all of those things. People actually, they don't go to the bars and go nightclub hopping so much. They just bring that into the living room, and they're actually in a bar watching it on a movie, and in that environment, in that spiritual environment, it desensitizes you. So you've heard me talk a lot about that. I'm not going to really go into it. It's just, I always like to preview those kinds of things, because it's really, in many ways, it's the little foxes that spoil the vine, but I'm not even talking about little foxes. I'm just talking about crude things, things that are violations against the Holy Ghost, things that grieve the Holy Ghost. If you don't know it or not, murder and revenge grieves the Holy Ghost, and a lot of things that go on in the entertainment realm really is just bringing you to revenge and vengeance, and there's murder involved, and there's all kinds of crimes of sexual immorality, and it has a way of bringing you in vicariously. And somebody said, I'm not certain of that. Well, let me just tell you, get yourself involved in a movie that has a thick plot of somebody who's done somebody else some terrible evil, and how that it just builds you up, and you're ready to see that person who's been doing all the bad stuff get punished. Well, it's got a way of bringing you in. You don't even know it. And so is the same way with all the rest of the nonsense and the immorality. You need to be careful, because what you want more than anything else is be able to go to bed tonight and say, "Lord, I just thank You that You're not only going to minister to me in the day as You have today, but You're actually going to come and visit me in the night, and I'm going to have Holy Ghost dreams. Lord, I'm just an expectation for that realm of visions to be in my life." And people, this isn't something that we try to do. This is something that we have because we make a connection. I believe the connection is what actually makes us that much more sensitive to the Holy Ghost. Not excluding the fact that you got to mind the things of the Spirit if you want to develop in the Spirit. If you want to develop in the Holy Ghost, then you're going to have to give yourself to the Holy Ghost school, Holy Ghost teaching. You know, if you're going to develop and inherit and have as a reward the very life of God, the life of God, my goodness, that, you know, when we start talking about the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, discerning of spirits, working of miracles, gifts of healing, we're talking about gift of faith. We're talking about the dimensions of the life of God. So, you know, where he can say to a mountain, be moved and cast. He says it is going to happen, you know. This is the authority of his word. Well, if you want that life of God or eternal life, if you sow to the Spirit, you should reap everlasting life. And literally, the synonym for everlasting life is the life of God. And of course, if you've been around me at any time at all, that's proven to you. Maybe some of you haven't. I'll give you one verse of scripture. John says, that eternal life was manifested unto us, and we have revealed it or showed it unto you. And he was referring to Jesus Christ, 1 John chapter 1, verse 3. But, you know, there are many, many verses of scripture help us to understand that when we're talking about eternal life, we're not just talking about some kind of an idea absent from the life of God, but it is the expression of God's life. So let me help you with making that connection in with the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to tell you tonight that, yes, you can make that connection with the Holy Ghost in prayer, but it's a different kind of prayer. And I'm going to talk to you about why it's a different kind of prayer. Yes, you make that connection with the Holy Ghost in worship, but it's a different kind of worship. And I'm going to help you understand tonight why it is a different kind of worship. You make that connection with God the Holy Ghost in thanksgiving, but it's a different kind of thanksgiving, and I'm going to help you by the help and the grace of God to understand how it's a different kind of thanksgiving. Because people would say, oh, Lord, thank you for my pillow, thank you for my bed, thank you for the air that I breathe, thank you for the eyes that I'm allowed to see through, the ears I can hear through, on and on. And it's just not very deep. You know, it's not very deep. I can't go deep with kumbaya, my Lord, kumbaya. I can't go deep with it because first and foremost, it is not faith. I'm asking the Lord to come by here, my Lord, in Swahili, a kind of Swahili. But he's already here. So I'm not going to ever make a connection with that first and foremost. Second of all, there's just nothing there. It's not deep. It's not real and it's not deep. And I use that as a great description. First of all, if you're going to make a connection with God, it's got to be in faith because you can be praying your heart out. It can be coming from your guts. But if it isn't truth, if it isn't faith, if it isn't the Word of God, it's just going to go nowhere. I'm telling you right now, you can pray a doubt and unbelief prayer as passionate as anyone, and it will profit you nothing. If you're going to go deep, you better go deep in spirit and in truth. I mean, that's what the Lord really wants. That's what he designed. That's what Father said. This is what I want. You know, Father, what do you want? I want spirit and truth worship. I want, and that really, you know, this is a hard thing to communicate. Worship isn't something that you do on Sunday mornings or during, you know, song service. Worship is a way of life. It is a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, on an altar for God, just to be what he's commanded us to be an altar before him, on an altar, to be the sacrifice, the whole thing, you know. He brings the fire, praise God. And, you know, getting these basics, getting these principles, we dichotomize our lives to no end. Oh, we're this at work, we're that at church, we're this at play. Multiple personalities, right, left, and center. I mean, come on. We're supposed to be alive in Jesus Christ, our whole. We no longer live. And people are trying to get to the point of, I no longer live. You're never going to get there because you're seeking it some other way. You've got to agree with God. I mean, no one ever had a testimony given to them by God like Mary did. Hey, God's going to be born on the inside of you. He's going to be conceived in your belly. You know? I mean, she had the right response. Be it unto me according to your word. She totally agreed with God, even though it was beyond all things imaginable. You're about to give birth to God. I mean, give me a break. Whatever has God ever said? That is more unbelievable than that, okay? And it's just like, I'm going to agree with you. And until you agree with God and say it's a done deal, He said it, it's established, and start thanking Him and worshiping for Him, you are not moving in faith, and thus you cannot have it, because it is impossible to please God without faith. And really, whatsoever is not of faith is actually sin. And because it's, and I don't want to get into that tonight, because there is, you know, that's a kind of a shocking statement that should cause all of us to say, wait, time out. What does that mean? But I'm not going to break that down tonight. I really want to just get you into seeking the Lord rightly, the way that you're supposed to. And I want you to understand that it isn't that difficult, but it is raw and real. It is the rawest thing you ever did, besides throwing a fit. You know what I'm saying? That's raw. Somebody just come throwing a fit and screaming and hollering and just saying, "That's just the way I feel about it." That is raw. It ain't real, but it is raw. Are you with me? Okay? That's like, you know, if you knew anybody else besides that person that was very intimate with you, was looking, you would never do it. Are you with me? You only throw a real bad fit in front of your mom. Don't really even do it in front of your dad. But your mom, you throw a bad one, or maybe your spouse, or maybe in front of a sibling. Because it has to be in front of someone whose opinion does not matter to you. Right? It's true. You're not going to get that raw. But God wants us to get raw and real, where it is really, we're shut in with Him in a private place, in a public place, and His opinion matters everything to us. But reality of it is, everybody else's opinion does not matter at all. Oh, that is a difficult, challenging thing to do. You need to practice. I'm going to talk about practicing the word of knowledge. I've never tried to function in a gift of the Spirit. If you try, it ain't real. It just comes. I mean, when I was standing that day, and I'll never forget this day because it was so dramatic in my life. It was one of those milestones in my life that not only did it have great consequence on a nation, it had great impact upon my own life. And so much of what God had done in my life brought me to this point where I'm standing on a stage, a platform in the nation of Nepal, and I'm weeping, I'm sobbing because this demon-possessed girl, I mean, she was wildly demon-possessed. If she was in the United States of America or in Europe, she would have been in a padded cell. She was a wild girl of the streets. I mean, everything about her hair was matted and just full of all kinds of nastiness. Her face was distorted. Her garments were rags. She's foaming at the mouth and rolling around the grounds there when that demon spirit began to manifest. And then later that evening, that was the morning meeting, later that evening she's standing there on the platform. They'd taken her, some of the Bible school students had taken her, and they'd gotten her a shower and gotten her some clean clothes, and she had one of the t-shirts on that was for the meeting, believing for the impossible. And she's standing there and I don't understand a single word she's saying because she was speaking in Nepali to that mass of 10, 12,000 people that were literally shouting because many of the people knew her. She was a street girl. And in a community like that, everybody's going to know everybody. I'm standing there sobbing, just weeping, just crying. And standing beside me, we're sobbing, we're weeping, we're just crying. We're being touched so deep in our heart and spirit, seeing this girl set free. We said, "Oh God, if it was for no other reason but for this one girl, Lord, we would do this all over again, all that we've gone through. Father, thank you for allowing us to be here." And I have an open vision. See, I'm not trying. I'm just connected. I'm about doing the master's business. I'm caught away deep inside my being, caught away with what God's doing. I have an open vision. And I see a 40-year war come to an end. And I see all of a sudden a church that is persecuted by a government suddenly becoming an ally of the government, being recognized by the government as legitimate. And so having seen it, I prophesied. And here you got all of these preachers and leaders, not just the pastors, but the leaders of the Presbyterian, leaders of the Assemblies of God, leaders of all of these major denominations that are there in Nepal, standing there listening with an intent look on their face as I prophesy. If I prophesied wrong, that would have been it. But it had nothing to do with that. You don't even care about that. When you're just declaring what you see, I mean, come on, baby, you don't have to worry or be concerned about anything. So I'm just saying, the 40-year war comes to an end. The government of Nepal now recognizes the church as an ally instead of a foe, and a federation of churches forms. Within 2 months, it all happened. Not trying to have a word of knowledge, not trying to have a word of wisdom, not trying to have a vision, just connected. And there's too many people trying to do this stuff, and it's bogus. It's just men's thoughts. And I mean, bless their hearts, they really want to get it. There's an ambition there. There's a zeal there. I'm sure that it's true and sincere, but it's just wrong. These things flow out of a realm so deep, and you're going to have to learn how to make a deep. I mean, some people are superficial. I don't think anybody in here tonight is superficial with God. Many people are superficial with God. You'll never make a connection with the Holy Ghost there. You got to go deep. Transparency, raw, real reality, just letting your hair down and saying, this is what it is, being willing to confess your faults and your sins one to another and pray. I mean, it's got to get that real. Playing pretend, trying to have a spiritual hairdo and a church smile ain't going to do it. You got to get raw with God and real with God. I mean, you got to learn a dependency upon the Lord Jesus Christ that comes out of this. But that isn't even a factor there. I'm not talking about sensitivity to the Holy Spirit tonight. I'm not talking about so much of foundational issues. I'm talking about how do you make a connection with the supernatural. And, you know, this is so fundamental for us. And now I'm going to show you, I'm going to help you with the words that God uses. And I want to start off with, as I've already set up a preface for this, that there's certain things that you want to be mindful of and remember with respect to all the things I've talked about in terms of sensitivity to the Holy Ghost, because that is a foundation of making a connection with God. So I'm going to read this verse of scripture to you here in Proverbs chapter 4 that many of you are familiar with. In verse 23, the scripture says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it proceeds or comes forth the issues of life. And I there is no verse of scripture that is better to really help us springboard off of the issues of life, understanding that this is the flow of the Holy Ghost. This is a wellspring flow. Dear people, if I can just get people to just start agreeing with God and stop listening to the voices and all the things that are vying for your attention and all the distractions and all the things that want to shape you and form you and fashion you, disappointments to appointments to careers and all the rest of stuff, and to say, wait a minute, I'm going to be shaped by the Word. I'm going to be fashioned by the Word. I'm going to get my identity from God. I'm not going to let anybody disappoint me. I'm not going to suddenly be robbed of my approval rating in heaven because of someone's opinion. Listen to me. I'm going to keep my heart with all diligence. I'm going to recognize this gift that God has given me. I'm going to be the apple of His eye. I'm going to be His number one choice. I'm first string in the Spirit kind of thing. You know, I'm God's pick. It takes confidence in God and boldness in God and assurance in God to make this connection. I'm acceptable. If you don't feel acceptable, you're not going to connect. If you're not His pick, you're not going to connect. If you don't believe that you have access by the Spirit, you're not going to connect. If you don't believe that you're accepted in the Beloved, you're not going to connect. If you can't have all boldness to enter into this realm of Holy of Holies, you can't connect. You've got to just embrace and accept what God has said. He said, you call upon my name and you'll be saved. I'll save your soul. I'll wash away your sins. I'll make a new creation out of you. And then you got to listen to all the, you got to put down all the lying voices and all, quit listening to all the things that says that's not true. You start obeying God, walk with God, let Him perfect everything that concerns you, and call Him the perfecter and the provider and protector. Call Him the Almighty, call Him El Shaddai, call Him the one who keeps you, sustains you, upholds you, who nothing can separate you from. I mean, on and on. You know, you get in the Word. Okay, but bottom line of it, this is a place where relationship gets built. I don't know. I mean, I can't tell you why, but when I was born again, I felt like God loved me more than He did anybody else. I didn't have any of these problems that a lot of people have. God doesn't love me. I'm not sure. He loves me, loves me not, loves me, loves me. I'm like, I had no right, no reason, no, it wasn't based upon genealogy, who my dad was, who my mother was, what my family heritage was. It didn't have anything to do with human ability. or a man's desire or purpose. It had to do with the Spirit of God just came and made me feel so confident in Him that I was the apple of His eye. I was His favorite child. What did that do? It released a deep worship in me. It began to develop an explosive worship in me. Because when God talks to us about where this flow comes from, He talks to us about the depths of our being. He uses words like kalia. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. John chapter 7 and verse 38. Out of your belly, out of your kalia, verse 39. Out of that which is the deepest part of your being. Surely not colon. But He's talking about out of, because in the Old Testament, you know, God uses these deep organs, these hidden away organs like kidneys to say He tries your kidneys. No, He tries the reins. He tries that which motivates you, that which is the decision-making factors, that which makes you tick, so to speak, in terms of your decision-making. He tries it. He didn't try it to prove it wrong. He tries it so that He can perfect it and show you how to have right decision-making processes. But He always uses these deep things. Splanknon. Philippians 1:8, splanknon. He's not talking about the, you know, the splankna or the some deep organ inside of your, you know, stomach. But He's going deep. He's going as deep as He can get. He said, I've loved you in the splankna of Jesus Christ. And what happened was, understanding that, the splanknon, understand that it was translated, I've loved you with the bowels of Jesus Christ. It's the deepest compassion, deepest passion, deepest affection, deepest emotion. Kalia, really, in the Attic Greek, speaks of the deepest of passions, the deepest of emotion. That's why these Hellenistic, you know, Greek philosophical ideas of somehow you're not supposed to, you know, be in the emotions. Well, you're not supposed to be in bad emotions. But tell me, a human being's not some kind of an emotion. God's full of emotion. Love is an emotion. And it's a passion. You know, and that's what kalia is in the Attic Greek. It speaks of your passions, your emotions. And so He says, that's where this wellspring's coming from. That's where this connection's coming from. It's coming from somewhere so deep. How do I get deeper? That's why fasting and praying is so important for so many people. It will break the most, you know, given over to spinning the propeller, intellectual lockdown person. It'll break them out of it. Amen. The hardest shell, it'll break them out of it because you're just desperate for God. Lord, I want to go deeper. You're right at the point of dying because you haven't had a bite to eat for 40 days or 4 days, or some people 4 hours. You know, you're like, God, I'm about to die over here. This is deep. When I fast, I can't sleep. I can't sleep. I maybe sleep 2-3 hours a night. I mean, it suddenly everything changes. It's a new dynamic. And, you know, you're just finding yourself crying out to God. There's a state of, God, I got to know you. God, I got to know you. God, I got to know you. Lord, I thank you that I know you, but I got to lay hold on you. Oh, God, lay hold on me. I'm going to lay hold on you. It just gets all, you know, mixed in there. I got to know you. It starts happening. Something's going deeper. You're placing a demand on yourself. Something's going deeper. It's no more a surface thing. Nothing can touch you as deep. No human relationship. And I love to put it on the scale of, remember that first crush you had, and then they didn't like you anymore, and how deeply it touched you. You couldn't eat. That gets eternally bigger with God. Many people have never touched that relationship. They've never come into that intimacy. They're always praying for abundant life instead of accepting it. It's been given to me. I didn't deserve one bit of it. God gave it to me. And agreeing with God, because faith is first and foremost agreeing with God. It's there also built upon that, trusting Him now that you've agreed with Him, recognizing that He's faithful. He's going to do what He's committed to say, what He's committed to saying He would do. He's going to be faithful. And then God explodes that supernaturally with a faith. But it's deep. It's a deep connection. It's a relationship that takes you to where it is so important to you that all other relationships become meaningless. It becomes meaningless, and now you begin to relate to other people just out of the relationship you have with Him. Now that relationship with them is far more meaningful because now it's real. It's not I love you today and I hate you tomorrow. It's not all this covenant breaking stuff. People, you know, you're just friends, you know, for just so long, and then, you know, it's all, you know, messed up because as soon as somebody does something you don't like, you're off to another, looking for another relationship, another friend. Now, covenant goes through all the hardships and harshness of the fallibility of people who are born again and don't know how to fully embrace the Holy Ghost. Connection. God uses kolia, out of your innermost passions, the depths of your being, shall flow gushes, rivers of the Holy Ghost. How to make that? That begins to be developed in worship. I don't worship to entertain people. There was a time in my life, honestly, I could care less whether anybody was singing along or not. I forgot. It wasn't that I care less because I cared less about people. It's just I care less because I was so captivated with God. Somebody had to shake me and say, did you know that we can see that you are caught away in glory, but none of the rest of us know what you're doing. My response was, well, you do that too. Just do it. Oh, no. We've got to have it all organized. It's got to be an overhead. It's got to be everybody singing the same song that somebody sang for the past whatever years. You never do that with prayer. Oh, where's a prayer? I got to pray a prayer. Where's a prayer? Give me that one that was written 4 years ago. I really like that one. You would never do that. You want it to be more intimately. Praise God. You want it to be more intimate. Somebody said, well, songs and music won't work that well. Yeah, it will. It will. It will. It will. But you got to let God take you deeper. You got to let God. You got to understand that there is a divine connection where all of a sudden you're standing there in that realm and prophecy will bust out of you. Tongues will bust out of you with interpretation. I mean, your faith will rise up in you. You'll just know what's going on. You'll just know what's needed. It'll just arrest you. You know, I'm accused a lot of times. People say, oh, well, that was insultive, or why did you do this, or why did you do that, or that was too radical. Hey, sorry, I'm just being raw and real here. I'm going with what God gave me to go with. He told me he was going to empower me to do this job, and I trust him, so here it goes. I'm not saying that I get it right every time, but I'm going to tell you right now, my heart is perfect before the Lord. I am devoted to saying, Lord, as it comes to me, I'm going to deliver it, and I'm going to trust you that you're the one who's going to bring it, because that's what you promised to do. Take no thought for what you should say in that self same moment, in that self same minute, in that self same hour, as it's translated, but literally that self same moment, the words that you're supposed to speak are going to come out of you. I believe in the working of the Holy Ghost to prophesy. I believe in. If I didn't, I couldn't do it. I would be restrained by self-consciousness. I would be restrained by second-guessing myself. I'd be restrained by so desperately wanting to be sure that I'm right. That's trusting you. That would be trusting me. I'm trusting Pops. I made a connection with him so deep inside that it has caused that all to be nonsense. It is really revoked its viable access to my feelings or thinking processes. I won't even go there. I can't even go there. I'm captivated. I'm in love. I'm goo-goo-eyed. I'm just over here. Right now I'm over there. Hallelujah. I found myself at times screaming to 100 people and feel the anointing so strong and feel the presence of God standing right beside of me. People would say, oh, that's not love, that's not God. I'm telling you right now. That's where you need to get a hold of some principles and God recognize, wait a minute, God's got an anointing that he puts on pastors and evangelists and prophets and apostles and teachers. You just don't want to mess with it. Amen. You don't understand it, fine. Just don't mess with it. be smart. And so I don't understand that, but you know why I'm not touching it? Amen. You know what I'm saying? Because it's just radical. I mean, in the Old Testament, we were called madmen. We were called droolers. Guys with spittle on our beard. There was various different words for us, just caught away. Ecstatics. Ecstatics is what it is. I'm ecstatically in love with God. I'm caught away in a realm that's causing every one of my cells to do backflips. Every cell of my body swinging from the chandeliers. so to speak. They're rolling on the ground, overwhelmed, jumping up and down with excitement. I made a connection out of the deepest part of my being. How do people get developed? You've got to quit being superficial. You can't be false. You can't make up things about yourself. Always trying to keep a certain, facade, as it were. No, just raw, real. This is who we are. This is what God's made us, and praise God. Hallelujah. Excuse me a minute. I'm gonna sob in front of you here. I'm gonna cry. I'm not worried about it. I'm gonna laugh. I'm not concerned about it. I'm just gonna move with God. A connection that is made in worship. A connection that's supposed to be made in prayer. I think it's a mess if you learn how to do that in church. I'm gonna say it again. I think it is a mess for people to try to learn how to get real with God in church. It's a mess. I'm happy for the mess, but it is a mess. Huh? Because people might be over there talking to the wall, banging on the wall. I got to get real. Oh, God, how do I get real? How do I get real with this? How do I get beyond that you're just right, that you're really here because I can't see? I got to get real. Now, when you get desperate, when you get passionate, when you get emotional, that's why I say it's, misdirected emotion is a mess. Misdirected passion is a mess, right? You want to get focused in that emotion and focused in that passion. You got to do that at home. You got to do that in the closet. Praise God. He said, go to the closet with that. Go to the closet with that. Develop that in the closet. Hallelujah. Praise God, there's people around like me that are models of what it means to worship God with all your heart, with all your soul. When you talk about that, when we're talking about heart, we're not talking about the life pump, but we're talking about something just as central and just as meaningful. When we're talking about the depths of men's thoughts, we utilize a word called liver. Yeah, it's not a liver in the Hebrew language, that is, okay? It's not the liver. But it's something that is so central and so essential to life that without it, you cannot live. You can't function. God wants it from the depths, all of our heart. Something so deep, so raw, so real. You got to quit playing pretend on every level to make this connection. You got to be willing to be broken before God. You got to be willing to be humbled. It's like I've heard many preachers say, as Tim said the other night, don't believe anybody who's not been broken. If they're not broken, the depths of their brokenness. I heard a preacher say it the other day. A preacher had been, his pastor's, one of the great churches of America, been pastoring there, I think, 38 years. And he said, it doesn't matter what people know. It's where's their brokenness? It's their brokenness. I was in a board meeting with him. He's one of the board members of a board that I'm on. Where's the brokenness? It's all about the brokenness. It's true, because that allows you to go deep. That allows you to get past your offenses and what you think people are thinking, what your disappointments and your discouragements and all this that you want for yourself and all that you want for yourself. All those things keep you from being real with God. And praise the Lord for the Spirit of truth that comes to work on us and say, look, we're going to have to learn how to speak the truth here. We're going to have to learn how to get real here. There's nothing hid. I tell you, you are bare butt naked before God right now. It's true. And he wants you to come to him and confess. He wants you to come to him with expressions that, oh God, you are so amazing what you've done for me. When I think about how undeserving, how there's no way, no reason, no explanation for why he would come and redeem sinful and twisted and wicked men and love them so ardently and so perfectly and save our soul and wash away our sins and make us brand new. And suddenly that is a reality and it's not a religious ideology. You collapse on the reality, the weight of the reality of who God is and his love for us will cause you to collapse. And this connection absolutely has to proceed. The greater demonstration of the Holy Ghost being able to be expressed and realized and manifested in our lives. To begin to worship the Lord with all my heart. To worship him not on the basis of men's idea. I had a dear preacher friend of mine that has a great church in South Africa. He recently posted, he said, I went to this great meeting, supposedly, and the worship band was a band. I never heard anything about Jesus. They sang all the songs, but there was nothing about the Almighty, His sovereignty, His glory, His beauty, His splendor. There was nothing there. And then they got up, and the sermon, and you know, and it just went on. It's just a standard status quo thing that people are caught up in, and they've not known anything different. Poor people, they've not known anything different. They've not known what it meant to go to the altar in front and cry out to God till the glory and the power of God rend their hearts and change took place, to stand up in His glory and begin to worship Him lavishly. They've never known it. And there's even people that have sat in Pentecostal models for many years and have never touched it because they've never gotten deep enough. They've never gotten raw enough. They've never gotten real enough. Some of it has impacts on your relationships around you. It definitely has impacts on their relationships of authority over you. It's true, true. God sets it up that way. You're going to have to be willing to start crossing the, you know, the T's and dotting the I's of truth in your life to be able to move forward in the spirit of truth, because He doesn't play games. He's not going to play false, fake. He's not going to have any notion, you know, of a lie. It's not going to be true. It's going to be real. It's not play make-believe no more. It's not make ourselves bigger than life, you know. It's to get real with ourselves. My breath is stinky in the morning. That's a terrible thing to say. It's trying to describe raw and real. But, you know, we gurgle, get all our breath smelling good, you know. Spray ourselves down with cologne. We make ourselves look good. Praise God, we do that. Praise God. Spend a little time in some of these nations. Papua New Guinea, forgive me if you're watching in Papua New Guinea, but this is just the truth. Hygiene is a thing that needs to be worked on there. You have to put Vicks nasal rub in your nostrils to be able to handle it, because a bird of paradise will fly up your nose. And it is not a good experience because the hygiene is terrible. Huh? But there has to be something more to us than all of that. All of the things that we do to make ourselves acceptable to human beings. We have to move beyond that. When all of a sudden your opinion doesn't matter to me anymore, I can truly love you. Your opinion will hold me in prison from ever really truly loving you with God, because I will always love you on the value of what you do for me. But all of a sudden, when it's no longer you, when it's no longer about you, something is, all I can say is the dynamic of it is just about Jesus. It's just about the power of God, the Holy Ghost. He takes us there in that focus into reality. I can't break it down to you psychologically. I cannot break it down to you emotionally, but I can tell you that that is true. As soon as what you feel about me no longer matters, it's no longer important. Why? Because I care less for you? No, I get to care more for you now. Because I'm so filled up, I have no need anymore for you to do something for me. Huh? I'm so filled with God's already done it. Now I can just be a conduit of His love flowing out. No matter what you do to me, it doesn't matter. I just say, Lord, don't hold that against him. He doesn't even know what he's doing. He doesn't mean it. He doesn't even know what he's doing. I won't break covenant with you because you can say all kinds of bad things about me and won't even have any problem. I just love you just the same. Love isn't changed. Hallelujah. It's amazing thing to get over here in this realm of making this divine connection. I'm going to tell you, at first it's like just moments. It is. It's like just moments. It's like moments of discovery. Wow, this is amazing. Huh? You've been in the meetings, right? And after the meeting, just like love everybody, just like loving everybody, you know, just those meetings. It's like those moments, huh? It's those altar call moments of having just gotten real with God, and you rise up from that, and all of a sudden the disposition of God is just there. You don't have to be sensitive. You made a connection. You made a connection. That's what church is supposed to be about. Church is supposed to be about not only us making that connection, but we now create an environment when people walk in, they're making this connection. They're going, what's going on here? I love Summer Spitzbergen's testimony. When she got saved, she responded to the altar call for salvation. She said it didn't happen then. She said it happened when all the people of the abiding place came up and started hugging me, and it was genuine. And I saw it was real. There was no fake nothing in it. It was real, true, genuine love. Huh? Everywhere my wife goes, people tell her everywhere, all across the world, you're the real deal. I've never seen such real, true love. True. What a pastor you have. What a person to learn from. Many people won't learn to come and say, they will never move beyond pride to humble themselves enough to learn. There are people, there's preachers that won't humble them. They're sick. They won't humble themselves enough to let another person pray for them. It's crazy. Pride of life is the worst hindrance to making connection. People say it's this devil and that devil and this spiritual wickedness. No, it's not. It's you and me. It's our unwillingness to simply obey God and cooperate with Him, humble ourselves before the mighty hand of God so He can lift us up into the realms of heaven. We used to sing the song, He will lift you up higher and higher and He, and I like the higher. I like to stay with the higher and higher and higher and higher. I mean, Father says, I want to expose every dimension of myself to you. The height, the breadth, the length, the depth. I want you to have the encounter of every dimension. People talk about levels. It's a misnomer. It's dimensions. I want to show every dimension of who I am to you so that you can be filled with all my fullness. And then He tells us on top of that He put the power on the inside of us. Isn't that amazing? My goodness, the school of the Spirit will cause you to connect with these things that is already right there. It's a package deal with the new creation. Just got to get raw and real. I worship the Lord. You know, the Lord says, here's what I want. Here's my will for you. This is what I desire. Because a lot of times we're telling God about what we want Him to do for us. Lord, I want you to do this for me. Oh, God, do that for me. Oh, God, use me this way. Oh, God, use me that way. And most of it's good. And it's meaningful, and it's sincere. But hold up. Father, what do you want? What can I do for you? He says, I want you to love me. I don't want fake love. I don't want to love today, hate tomorrow, and I can tell you right now whether it's real or not. I can tell you how deep it is. I can tell you how meaningful it is. And He doesn't reject us when it's shallow. He works with us to make it deep. Come on, man, isn't that great? He's amazing. You know anybody like that. There's none like Him. He looks at us and says, that is the shallowest love I've ever seen. But I'm going to make it deep in you. I'm going to make it deep. I'm going to perfect that which concerns you. I'm going to work with you until everything about your life is conformed to my image that looks just like me. I'm going to grow you up. I'm going to mature you. I'm going to develop you into all the fullness of that which I have for you. It's amazing, God. But some people don't want to humble themselves. You got to break. Got to be broken. You got to fall on the rock and be crushed. Of total dependency. God, I can do nothing without you. See, it's a relationship thing. It is not a legalistic thing. It is not some kind of formula. It's intimacy with God. Father says, I want you to love me with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And you know, that word that we translate strength is moed in the Hebrew language. It's like mucho. It is. It's like mucho mas. It's equivalent. It's mucho. I want you to love me with your mucho. It's true. Moed. Here, the Lord said, I want you to love me with your mucho. Okay, Lord, I'm going to give you my mucho. I'm going to give you my moed. I'm going to give you, that's like everything. That's everything. That's it. It's it. It's everything. I want you to. How do we make that connection? That's raw and real. That's radical, man. That's hair messed up. That's like sweating. That's like Jesus. That's like David dancing with all of his might. It's true. He was beautiful to Father. It was the Holy Ghost that did that. He was so earnest to get it right, you see. He got it wrong. His best friend, one of his best friends, died over his error in how to approach unto God. He wanted to get it right. Obed-Edom's house is being blessed. I want my house to be blessed. I want the nation of Israel to be blessed. I want God in my midst. See, that's what he's really saying. He's bringing up the Ark of the Covenant. It's not a religious icon for him. It's God in his midst. It's God. It represents God in my midst. It was more than a representation of God in his midst. It was God in his midst because Father came. And that was the central focus of the covenant. Like the blood of Jesus is the central focus of the new covenant. It was central focus to the old covenant. Everything is activated in God around the blood of Jesus. Everything was activated in God around the ark. I want that. And when that sincerity began to create a divine eruption in his life that people who were in the pride of life despised.
What a shame. You expose yourself to the handmaidens of Israel today. You disgrace.
And yet what happens, what has to happen in our life is it's so real, it's so intimate. And so the enemy will come along and say, yeah, see, you're just terrible. You're just raw and real. You're ugly. You need to settle down. You're a poor representation of heaven and of God. If you would just settle down, act like everybody else, maybe some of you might be able to impact somebody's life. All lies. To where I become more self-conscious and more concerned about what people think about what I'm doing, supposedly only to Him. And that's not truth anymore. That's not all my heart anymore. You're in it. That's like me kissing my wife through you. Hey, babe, I'm going to give you a kiss. Come here, Randy. Yeah, that's gross, isn't it? It's gross. It's repulsive. It's an abomination. Yes, it is. Agree with me. Hallelujah. I'm going to go on right to the dad. I'm going right to the father. I'm not going to do what I do to you for your approval. This is not for entertainment purposes. We've made it entertainment. We made it merchandise. But it's regardless of what we made it, what is it really supposed to be? The connection. The splanchnon. The bowels. That which is an organ functioning in the midst of your stomach. Your heart, your soul, the depths of your being, your spirit, that which is hidden away, that which is so deep, is so deep. And that's what the Lord is doing. He's just talking about the depths of what we need. You find out the depths of what you need when you're really hungry, when you're desperate, when you're really thirsty, when your life is in peril, when that person that you love more than anyone else suddenly decides they don't love you anymore and going to divorce you. There's no greater crisis, I don't think. It's no greater, it's easier to for that person to die than to reject you. That goes deep. Goes deep. It's far worse than the effect of the crush. I pray that no one in here knows it. If you've known it, I pray you never know it again. This is a terrible thing. Terrible curse. For your children to suddenly say, to cuss you out and walk away from you and say, I want nothing to do with you. The depths of that pain. I praise God, I've never known any of that. But I've looked in the eyes and I felt the dimension of the hurt in other people's. Because see, the beautiful thing about God is He lets us feel the hurt and the pain of someone else's infirmities. If I can be touched, if any two or three of you are touched by anything like this, huh? The effectiveness of the prayer that goes on, the agreement of that prayer being touched by that need. God allows us to touch it, feel it. Oh, and everyone to look in their eyes and to see the sleepless nights and the deep pain of rejection. Oh, to hear the uncontrollable sobs of the person rejected. Huh? It's a terrible thing. One person said to me, said it like this, said, I never knew that sobbing and crying could come like vomits. We're just uncontrollable. It takes over. You have no power. You just sob. You sob. You sob. You sob. See? Deep. Is that deep? Oh, Papa takes us so deep, much deeper. We just got to get out of the facade. We got to get out of the casual. We got to get out of that which we've called intimacy with Him and say, Lord, I don't know how to do this. But I've come to live in you and to dwell in you and abide in you. And I'm going to draw on you. And he begins to help us understand how much He loves us. And then that begins to make the thing happen. You love me that much? And I respond to that love. I don't know. I can't parse this out for you, but I do know that fasting and prayer is a big part of it. I just started, when I gave my life to the Lord, I was just fasting and prayer. Nobody told me I needed to. Nobody was around me telling me I had to. I just knew I had to. I read how that Jesus was baptized of the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit immediately drove Him out into the wilderness, and that was good enough for me. I saw what happened, you know, to the three men of the Old Testament that fasted 40 days, and I saw how God used them. I saw the impacts everywhere I turn, even among the people of God and the history of the church over the past 1,000 years, and I can get so many books just over the past 300 years, you know. Tim was talking about Franklin Hall and fasting and prayer. I read all of those books. And I was driven to fasting and prayer. I want to touch this. I want to touch this. I want to touch this. And I guess that had a part of it. I can't parse it out for you. I can't say it's necessary, but I know that all of us are called to do it. Jesus did it. Something happens there. Something happens to us. I didn't fast 40 days, but I fasted all the time. You know, I found even, you know, I have different counsel that I give people on fasting because I've learned things that you should do and things that you shouldn't do. But I believe God blessed every bit of it. The things that you shouldn't even do, Father blessed it. Like fasting and going to work, cross-eyed. You know, can't think, trying to think, but nothing's happening. I'm trying to think, but all I can think of is food. It's really supposed to be fasting and prayer, but Father honored it. He honored it. Hallelujah. It just grips me. It grips my life. The grace of God just grips our lives. And we have to be seated for it. If you don't ever hear about it, you won't be seated for it. Some people say, well, you know, you were just born passionate. Okay. Well, you were too. Yeah. Oh, no, my grandfather. I'm not talking about your grandfather. My grandmother, my mother, my aunts, my uncles. I'm not talking about your genealogy. I'm talking about what you were born by the will of God, not by bloods or genealogies, not by the will of flesh, not by the will of man, but this divine activity, the power of the will of Almighty God, who puts within us everything that we could never have by ourselves. Puts in us everything that he has desired from us. Huh? David had the heart of God because God found a man he could put his heart in. That's where he got the heart of God, right from God. Hallelujah. Just like Saul got the heart. He got a new heart, a heart like Father's. He was changed. He had a new heart. I was changed. I got a new heart. I'm not going to allow stuff to desensitize that. That's why I said at the beginning of the meeting tonight, understanding being sensitive to the Holy Ghost is so important, so foundational. Making those connections. I was able at early on in my life with God, and I've watched other people this way too. Just I was easily able to make a connection with God. I think a part of it was I lost a value for anything else. I don't know how that happened. I don't know what all. I can't tell you. I just lost a value for everything else. All that meant anything to me. Nothing was valuable to me. You know, it's one of the things that Franklin Hall will tell you. If you read his book, I haven't read his book for a long time. I read his book back in the 70s, early 80s. I can't remember. He'll say, what happens through fasting and praying is everything loses its value to you. Well, that just happened to me. It just lost its value. It lost its meaning. Fasting and praying did help that. I had one desire. One desire. It was just born in me. When I was born again, it's born in me. I have one desire, that will I seek after, that I may behold you in your sanctuary, that I may see your glory, huh? As I have seen you. Huh? And when the psalmist said that, he's talking about face to face. And I'm going, Lord, I want that. I got to have that. The idea, the notion of being able to see Jesus, the notion of being able to handle him, being able to have, I heard about other people, had Jesus come to them. I got to have that. And if I found somebody that said Jesus comes, I'll sing them. What song are they singing? What do they drink? What do they eat for breakfast? What are they wearing? Wingtip shoes? No problem. Get rid of my sandals. Wingtips. Whatever. You know, just like, I got to have this. Totally unnecessary. But passion. Splanknon. Kolia. Heart. The deepest affections. The deepest emotions, the deepest desires, your reins. What is your real desires? Your kidneys. The deepest desires, that which is deepest in you. Think about it. I just want you to consider that God the Holy Spirit would take you to a place of affection and deep love and affection for him. That which I was describing concerning divorce and concerning broken relationship is so minuscule in comparison to the depths of the affection. To the depths of the love, to the depths of the dependency, to the depths of the intimacy. Father would like for us to know a love that passes knowledge. You with me? Yeah. He wants us to know the love of Christ Jesus, who with joy went to the cross. He wasn't agonizing in the garden about going to the cross. That wasn't the human Jesus. No. He was divine through and through while he had a human body. Hallelujah. Hebrews tells us very clearly what that was. He wrestled with the powers of darkness and was at the point of death, to the point that he was sweating blood. I mean, when you're that at that point, you're about dead. You're about dead. You're about, it's about over for you. Ask any physician. You are at the point of death. Let this cup pass from me. He's talking about dying in the garden. And Hebrews said he was heard. He was heard. God delivered him from that death. He was heard because of why? The depths, the deep cries and pleas of urgent pleading, which is what supplication in the Greek language means. Urgent pleadings. Huh? What are you there? When urgent pleadings, where do we know that? I'm about to die here. My life is in peril. If right now a nuclear bomb, and we're not far from it, exploded at Camp Pendleton, and it wasn't one of ours, there would be some urgency and desperation. Hey, if we saw the nuclear blast, which is an unmistakable light, flash right outside right now. You listening to me? Self-preservation is a powerful, powerful emotion. It's a deep one. It will. Many people under those kinds of states, fear, they lose their entire composure. They collapse. They faint. They faint. They lose their bowels. They lose it. Because they've never had to experience anything like that. Huh? There's something far more awesome than that, an encounter with God. And here in His mercy and His love, He takes us gently. Huh? He doesn't cause us to be overwhelmed. He just says, oh, how much you want? How much you willing to let me love you? Huh? I love you with everything, but how much you willing to let me love you now? How much are you willing to receive my love? I want to pour my love into you. I want to pour my love into you by my Holy Ghost. I'm going to do it for you. I know you don't know how to love. Here, let me fill you up with it. Huh? I don't know. I know you don't know what you're doing. Here, let me fill you up with it. And you say, I want that. Well, there's a connection to be made. And there are things that you can do to cooperate with that. And it begins to get, Lord God. It begins to get joy in that worship. It's worship is never casual anymore. You'll never stand on the sideline, you know, humming or whistling, huh? Or being cool or whatever. You know what I'm saying? I'm just trying to give a little bit of a gamut here of what I see go on pastorally for 35 years. Like you're going, you're watching somebody. And I'm going to tell you right now, just understand this. Understand this. If you're standing in a service, and a worship service, and I don't care where it's at, and you're not worshiping, it is a reflection to you of how clueless you are of who God is. Understand that. It is true. Because I don't care where you're at. I had to go to a Roman Catholic idolatrous church. I mean, there was idols everywhere. Huh? It was a wedding of a relative. There was idols everywhere, and there were people bowing down to it and doing incense and throwing flowers at it and saying prayers. They opened up the hymn book and started saying something about Jesus. I went there. I went, my voice started carrying. People are looking around going, because I'm gonna go. I wasn't seeking attention. I wasn't trying to disrupt the meeting. I'm just being. You brought it on. You brought worship here. I've been trained by the Holy Ghost to do this. I'm lift up my voice and sing. Hallelujah. There's a connection of the deepest affections and passion. It isn't always going to be loud, because really, by and large. Passion isn't necessarily loud. Deep affection isn't necessarily loud. Sometimes it can be very quiet. And we can talk about different natural dispositions of deep things that impact us where we get real quiet. It just goes really, really deep. And I love it all. I love the quiet, deep, just soaking in His glorious presence to the shouts that bring doesn't bring the root down, it blows the thing completely off. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Mandara sete kilima. The connection. And that connection. As I was said at the very beginning, when we were standing there on the platform in Nepal, this is historically correct. The biggest outdoor meeting that ever took place in the nation for Jesus. somewhere between 10 and 12,000 people. 2006. I'm standing on that platform. That's what all God did. It was all a miracle. Nobody came, but Jesus showed up. Amen. And he drew people. He brought them. He brought them. And we're just standing there. And I am just captivated and weeping. And I was quiet as you could be. I was just sobbing, You could hear me go. If you were listening real quick, real carefully, you could hear me going, trying to catch my breath because it was just so deep. Just sobbing. Connection. Because it was real. It's true. Just about every time before I preach or minister, you'll see me make the connection. I'll make it every time. I'll worship till I go there. There's many times I start worship, I'm not there, but I'll worship till I go there. Hallelujah. Used to take me a little bit longer. It takes me, didn't take me long at all. I'm right there. I go right there. Hallelujah. That's where I get filled. There's a connection that's made. If I'm getting ready to preach in some place, I don't care what they're singing. They could potentially be singing Kumbaya, and I'll change the lyrics. I'll change the lyrics, and I'll go there. I'll go there. Instead of singing Kumbaya, I'll be saying, I thank you that you hear, oh Lord. I thank you that you hear. Hallelujah. It's true. Didn't matter what they're singing. Didn't matter. We walked into a church not too long ago, and we walked in. My wife is very sensitive. She goes, what on earth is this? This is spooky. What is this? I said, smile. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Smile. Pray in the Holy Ghost. And smile. I thought you were like this. She's like, this is weird. Smile. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Just pray in the Holy Ghost. She's over there. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you right now, there was a divine connection made. The power, we just discovered it. We're not overwhelmed by what everybody else is doing. We let God overwhelm us with what he's doing. And when we're overwhelmed by what he's doing, it changes everything that everybody else is doing. Because I'm telling you right now, when I stood in the platform, the power of God sat down on that place. And it was hard to see the back because it was probably, it was a huge building. There was over 2,000 people there. You couldn't see the back. But the power of God sat down in that place. Yeah. And I'm going to sit there, well, I just don't agree with this kind of worship. I look at the short dress and the green hair and the ring in the nose. And so all the stuff. You're just separating. You're not making a connection with God there. It's criticism. It's strife. It's suspicion. It's your own opinions. It's your own lack of love. It's you seeing everybody, not seeing Jesus. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Smile and pray in the Holy Ghost. What is it? Smile and pray in the Holy Ghost. She just never been in that before. She never saw all the many dancers and that many flags going on all at once. And that kind of, it was just a little overwhelming. Pray in the Holy Ghost and smile. She touched it. It didn't take long. She touched heaven. Every time we get in a different situation, praise God, we got somebody there helping us. Hallelujah. I hope. Now, she was disagreed with me. What is a disagreement? Not submitted. Period. She didn't trust me. She's just going to argue about it. You know what? She's just going to be completely doing whatever. Ruining the whole program. For her, not for me. Huh? Because if it ain't God, I ignore it. Huh? Can you hear me? If you get nothing else, we're like, if it isn't God, ignore it. Huh? The doctor said you were going to die? Ignore him. He's not God? Ignore him. The lawyer said they're going to sue you? He's not God? Ignore him. Huh? Your body says you got a stomach ache? It's not God? Ignore it. Oh, praise the Lord. Things in distraction, this and that, not going your way? Ignore it. And it's real easy to, when you're just consumed with extravagant worship, lavish praise and thanksgiving. Isn't it beautiful how the Lord set this up for us to step into all his glory and power? Huh? He just did it on the basis of love. You talk about the love language, I'm telling you right now. How easy Father made this. He made it the connection to be found within the framework of what he created us to be. He created us in love. He created us from the foundation of the earth to be together with Him in love. Ephesians 1:3. To be in love. Huh? Hallelujah. Fish were made to swim. Birds were made to fly. Saints were made to praise. I mean, and we just got to start understanding that that is now where God, the Holy Ghost, begins to develop the connection. You know, I want to come along, people, and say, would you quit doing what it is you're doing while they're worshiping with all their heart? Because that's going to be a substitute to keep you from ever having what God wants for you. But as long as I can see that they're going after God with all their heart, they're going to be just fine. If they think they've arrived, you ain't even close. Because I'm telling you this in a perspective of that which I've lived out, and I'm telling you, I have not arrived. I am pressing in. I'm grabbing a hold of that divine connection where the fullness of the love of Christ grips me, where I live under such that framework of that divine power and glory that these wonderful expressions of the Holy Ghost are continuous. I can tell you this. I've had times in my life, and I want it to be all the time, but it's just been times. And I could say maybe somewhere between 10 and 15 times a year, you know, a little more than once a month. It used to be a whole lot less than that, where I am so overwhelmed by the compassion of God, I'll just start sobbing. And when I am, it's always connected with my life with a miracle anointing. As soon as that compassion, that deep compassion comes upon me, and I'm overwhelmed and I'm crying and I'm sobbing, there's a thing going on where God is allowing me to see into people's lives the way He sees, to come and move with His love and His grace to bring healing. I want that to be all the time. It's not all the time, and I want it to be all the time. And all I know is this: I'm growing and I'm maturing and I'm desperate about it. And I get so concerned when people act like somehow they're there and they don't want instruction. You know, when you have to deal with someone who's been saved for 6 months and they're telling you that they disagree with you on some basic point in the Bible, like submitting to those who have the authority over you. I disagree. You're like, there is no place of reality here. There is no nature, real nature change here. Huh? Because it's like, I'm so hungry to know God. What is it going to take? I'm here. Teach me. Amen. School of Spirit. Making the connection. Understand. It's deep. It's splanknon. That's a Greek word. Philippians 1:8. Splanknon. The bowels of Christ Jesus. Paul expressing how he's interacting and how he's loving the church. With the splanknon. Jesus. This compassion. This deep compassion. With the kolia, where the rivers come. The deepest part of emotion. The deepest part of emotion. John 7:38 and 39. With all of the heart, the Decalogue, the precedes to the Decalogue, Deuteronomy chapter 6, something that is repeated again in the Gospels by the Lord Jesus. It goes to a whole nother level when God says He's poured His Spirit in us, poured His love in us by the Holy Ghost. Romans chapter 5, I believe it's verse 6, or is it verse 7? The utterances of tongues, once again, not being something that's surface, it is so deep, so deep. The very central part of your being, like your heart. The essence of your being, like your soul. The vital function of your life and existence, like your spirit. The description of every dimension of your thoughts, like your mind. Captivated, caught away, consumed with the fire of His presence. Burning with His presence. Burning with His reality. Burning with His grace. Burning with that which He imparts to us to function in. And it gets brighter and brighter and brighter and brighter and bigger. You make these connections, I'm going to tell you right now, as you do, you'll discover the flow of the gifts of the Spirit through your life. And really, when I'm talking about making the connection, I really fundamentally am talking about the gifts of the Spirit. But let me just say this. For me, that's where it really truly is for the gifts of the Spirit. But also you're going to have the fruits of the Spirit there too. I mean, I really, honestly, I can't separate the two. You got the gifts, you got the fruit, you got the fruit, you got the gifts. And but I must say to you, for me, and this is personal experience, and you just take this with a grain of salt, which is always good for the sacrifice. Just take this with a grain of salt. Because it's my relationship with the Lord. You've got to have your relationship with the Lord. I can't put my relationship with the Lord on you except for when it's in those general categories that the Word of God describes. But you can learn from them because it's viable, okay? All I do now is if I'm not overwhelmed with the joy, I just say, Holy Spirit, fill me with your joy. And it happens really quickly. It did it at first. We develop in it. We mature in it. At first, it's like, oh, Lord, I don't feel any joy. Help me here. Oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God. I got to go stand in front of people right now, and I don't feel joy at all. I feel the opposite. It's true. So now I begin to understand how I can rule my feelings. My feelings don't tell me how I feel anymore. I tell my feelings how I feel because I submit myself to the Holy Spirit and that flow of heaven. The fruits of Bastelia La Mapa. Because I'm dependent upon Him. Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect by your human ability? No, by having begun in the Spirit, I'm now made perfect by the Spirit of God. Huh? Galatians 3:3. What a wonderful scripture, eh? Help us understand this. Huh? You're getting some crisis moments for me. All I can do is just say, Holy Spirit, fill me with your love. You see where I'm going right now. And you know, there's times, I'll say this. Because love is not as overt as joy. You know? And I feel a little bit of trepidation. I'm going to go to a situation where people don't like me. And I say, Lord, fill me with your love. Let your love overflow me. Overwhelm me. And I won't feel anything at that moment of time. But as soon as I step out of the car and I begin to walk before them, towards them, I'm overwhelmed with a literal presence of the Lord, a company of the Lord. And I'm overwhelmed with love for them. And a smile, not a fake smile, a real smile. Not a churchy smile. Not put that little church boy smile on your face like Mama said, otherwise I'm spanking your bottom when you get home. And believe me, she told me that. You smile right now. Don't embarrass me or you're getting a spanking. Real smile, Holy Ghost smile, real love, real affection. And now you get to talk with people. There's no intimidation. There's no trepidation. You're not concerned about what they feel. You're just overwhelmed with a love for them. Let them say whatever they want. Let them, it doesn't bother you. Huh? I want to live in that all the time. Yes. And Father says, okay, I want you to live in that all the time. Will you yield your members? Will you ask me? Will you rely upon me? Will you look to me for it? Will you just simply shut you down here? And recognize, wait a minute, we're not doing your program. Amen? That's called denying yourself. We're not doing your program. You are dead. Hello. You are, whether you believe it or not. And your life is hid with God. Hallelujah. In Christ. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
And isn't it wonderful that God keeps establishing things and calls it so even when we're not in full agreement?
True.
He's amazing. He's a God of mercy. He's a God of love. I pray tonight in the name of Jesus, you grab a hold of him. I don't care what you're going through. Huh? If a person every day is falling into sin and they're crying out with desperation, oh God, I don't want to live this way. They're right. A person who just makes excuses for it and goes on like nothing's a big deal, they're wrong. And I don't care what it is, even on the level of strife. And that, even on those, because strife is in the pride dimension and it's subtle. Don't allow it. Arguments, don't allow it. When the Lord showed me many years ago that argument was the same as strife, I got done. I'm finished. It was a revelation to me. Because we are excuse for an argument. It's a debate. We're having a, you know, discussion. No, you arguing. That's strife. And then I discovered myself actually entering into strife over His Word. And I'm like, oh, God. And that's, when you get a revelation, you just collapse. And I'll go, Lord, I'm so stupid. Please forgive me. You know, what can you do? I had a revelation. I thought I was a champion God's ideas. No, I was entering into strife with His Word. So praise God for His hand, molding hand. Let's just see God. Just say, Lord, there's nothing wrong with saying, Lord, I don't get it. But I want to get it. And getting real with it. I don't get it. It's your fault. Not mine. And I'm not obligated. No, I don't get it. But it's always in the context of, I'm desperate for it. Teach me, because he's going to teach you. He's going to teach you. He's going to teach you. If God's going to be patient with you, how much more patient should you be with yourself? Hallelujah. And I assure you this. I'm certain of this. I want to promise you this. God is far more patient with you than I am. Or any other pastor. Or even you are with yourself. He is. Hallelujah. I want to be as patient as he is. But I'm going to have to give myself more perfectly, yielding my mirrors to him. Saying, Lord, I'm not doing it on myself. I'm going to make that connection. I'm going to be sensitive. School of Spirit. Aren't you glad you're in it?
Yes.
Look, just people, just simply do what God's told you to do. Because that's where the favor is. That's where the miracles are. That's where the blessings are. People want to have the blessings and the favors and the miracles, and they don't want to go out and tell people about Jesus. I'm telling you, it's not going to happen. You're not burdened for the lost. You're never going to happen. Have these things happening. Because God put all the blessings and all the favor and all the supernatural working in the context of us going loving people, loving their souls into heaven. You know, breaking off the strongholds. People, come on. This is easy. This isn't hard. It's not an awkward moment. This is a heavenly moment. Let God show you how. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, shout to the Lord. Say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for the abiding place. Thank you, Father, for the Abiding Place Church, for a hungry people. Father, thank you for everybody that has heard tonight. We thank you for the listening ears. For Lord, you gave men the ability to hear natural, and you give us the ability to hear spiritually. Thank you, Father, for the seeing eye. For you give us the eyes to see in the physical and the natural, and you've given us the eyes to see in the spiritual. And we look to you, Father, for it all, not to ourselves, but to you, O God, the one who has performed it, set it, established, created it, and settled it forever. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Will everybody stand with me? Look around, see if there's anybody you don't like. No. If there is, forgive them right now from your heart. Find a bunch of people around you and tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Walk in the Holy Ghost.